Hey there, big news from the React team. On April 25th, they made waves with the release of React version 18.3 and the debut of version 19 in beta. What's more, they've also shared an article detailing the exciting additions in the beta version 19. From fresh hooks to updates on existing ones, there's a lot to unpack. So, grab your seat, hit that like button, and let's dive into it all together. Indeed, diving into React 18.3 is a great starting point. Let's kick things off by checking out a tweet directly from the React team to uncover what's new. We also published React 18.3 to help apps prepare for React 19. This release is identical to 18.2, but adds additional warnings to make the upgrade to React 19 easier. We recommend apps upgrade to 18.3 to prepare for React 19. As you've probably gathered, the release comes with numerous warnings but doesn't introduce any new functionality. I'll be posting a comment below the video asking, would you like a review of the 18.3 warnings? If the comment receives 50 likes, you'll get your video. Now, let's turn our attention to the beta version of React 19. First and foremost, it's noteworthy that there's no mention of the React compiler in the announcement. Here's hoping it didn't make it into the beta, but will be included in the final release of version 19, keeping our fingers crossed and remaining hopeful. Moving on to the main content, React team has introduced a new feature called Actions. It's important not to confuse this with server actions. They're different entities. Perhaps it's best to begin with forms. Let's explore a quick example of how forms currently function. Here we have a controlled input that updates the state on onChange, a familiar concept. To handle form submission, we utilize the onSubmit method. This method passes the event as its first parameter, requiring us to prevent its default behavior before proceeding to send the data to the server. Until now, this has been the standard practice we've grown accustomed to. However, change is on the horizon. Let's explore an example of how Actions revolutionizes form handling, offering a fresh approach. In the form tag, instead of onSubmit, we utilize the action property. Our callback receives an object of type form data as the first parameter, a browser-based API. If you're unfamiliar with it, I'll include a link to MDN in the description. The key point here is that all form data is encapsulated within this object. Consequently, we can use uncontrolled inputs. Notice that we no longer require the use of value and onChange in our input. As a result, we eliminate the need for state variables and the accompanying re-renders for each keystroke in the input. It appears that this marks a move towards browser-centric form handling. The only issue with the default behavior of the form is that it resets after callback handling. There might be a way to configure this behavior, but I haven't yet determined how. Just using the action property isn't quite enough. We've also got this handy tool called the useActionState hook. It goes hand in hand with the action property. Let's dive into a simple form example to see how they team up. We've set up a form and assigned a form action to the action property. We'll discuss this in more detail shortly. What's the purpose of this form? Well, it allows us to enter a new username in the input field and then send that new name to the server when we hit the submit button. When we submit a new name, it replaces the current one. We store the current name in a state variable, and if it exists, we display it. And of course, we need to handle errors. If an error occurs, we show it to the user, and it's also stored in a state variable. The main goal of our form, as you might have gathered, is to update the current username. Now let's delve into the hook itself. UseStateAction returns three parameters. First, there's pending, which is a Boolean value that turns true while data is being sent to the server. FormAction is a callback that must be provided to the form component. It interacts with the same state where we store the current name and any errors. Now let's discuss the initial state of this hook. The second parameter allows us to pass the initial state to the hook. In our example, it's an object with two fields. The first parameter is a function that receives two arguments, the previous state before the form was submitted, and the form data containing all the data from the form. Next, we proceed to send the form data to the server. Consequently, we extract the values from the input named name and receive the variables error and new name in response. The final step is to handle the response from the server. If an error occurred during data transmission, we return the error and keep the previous name in the name field. If there was no error, we return null in the error field and the new name in the name field. As you've likely surmised, whatever we return in this function will be reflected in the state variable in the subsequent render. Let's see how it operates in the browser. Initially, there's no name displayed. We input any new name into the field, then click Send. While the request is in progress, the Submit button is disabled. Once the request is completed, we see the updated current name. We can continue updating the name as many times as we like. However, the React team didn't stop there. They aimed to enhance convenience when working with actions further. They provided us with the useFormStatus hook. I attempted to import it in the current beta version, but it seems they forgot to include it in the source code. Let's examine an example from the documentation. The concept here is that if useActionState is positioned high up in the component hierarchy and we need to access the loading state further down, we can simply read the pending state from the useFormStatus hook instead of passing it down through props or context. It's a small but delightful convenience. The React developers didn't stop there. They decided to introduce another hook called useOptimistic. Let's revisit our example with the new username. In most scenarios, we're confident that the server will function flawlessly and the username will be updated. As a result, the React team proposes that we display the updated name to the user right away, instead of waiting for the server response and then refreshing the user's screen. Let's examine how it operates in code. We start with the new useOptimistic hook, which takes the current name from the state as a parameter. We'll understand why this is needed shortly. Similar to the regular useState hook, it returns both a value and a setter for that value. Before sending the data to the server, we assign a value to optimistic name. This allows us to display the updated optimistic name value to the user immediately, even before we receive a response from the server. Let's observe how this operates in the browser. We input a new name, and it appears instantly on the screen. Even though the button indicates that the request to the server is still in progress, the user can see the updated name immediately. It's only a bit later that the button becomes active again. You're probably wondering what happens if an error occurs and the name isn't updated. Well, the mechanism is rather straightforward. If the server returns an error, we revert to the previous name in the state. Since the previous name is passed as a parameter to the useOptimistic hook, it updates the optimistic name variable back to its previous value. This ensures that the user sees the error message, and the previous name is displayed accordingly. That's how it works in basic terms. Whether these hooks are enough for bigger projects and developers' needs is still uncertain. They might do the job for simple forms, but for more complicated stuff, we'll have to wait and see. Share your thoughts on these hooks in the comments below. The next big feature is the new use hook. Personally, I find the name a bit tricky. It might be hard to search for problems related to it on Google, but that's how it is. What does it do? Well, it takes a promise as its first input. To understand it better, let's check the documentation. Imagine we have a page with comments promise as a prop. We pass this promise down to the comments component. It's crucial to wrap the comments component in suspense. Now, with the use hook, we can finally wait for the result of the comments promise and instantly display the comments. It seems like suspense displays a loading state until the use hook finishes waiting for the promise to execute, and then it immediately shows the comments. But looking at the example, I have quite a few questions. What happens if there's an error, and how does it handle additional renders? Also, initializing the comments promise from above and passing promises as props seems like a strange idea to me. Let's try to understand it all. We have a beta version of this hook, and I've drafted some similar code. For instance, we have a fake getComments method that should return comments based on the article ID. It returns a promise that resolves in 2 seconds. Then, I decided to call the getComments method directly in the use hook, which I find convenient and easy to understand. Let's check out what happens in the browser. When we refresh the page, we notice a loading state for a few seconds. Then, our comments appear. However, we also see a warning in the console. A component was suspended by an uncached promise. Cached promise sounds intriguing. Now, let's see what they say about it in the article. Use does not support promises created in render. If you try to pass a promise created in render to use, React will warn. To fix, you need to pass a promise from a suspense-powered library or framework that supports caching for promises. In the future, we plan to ship features to make it easier to cache promises in render. To be honest, I'm not entirely sure how they intend to cache the promise either, so I started coming up with some solutions. My first attempt was to use useMemo. I wrapped the request in useMemo to create a promise only when the component mounts, and it seemed to work, but there were some nuances as it turned out. Let's take a look at a quick example. I've added a useState where I pass a function. This reminds me that it's only called once when the component first mounts. Then I added another console log inside useMemo with empty dependencies. Additionally, I included useEffect with empty dependencies, which also contains a console log. So, let's see what's happening in the browser. We reload the page, and we notice the loading state along with 2 logs in the console. After a moment, we see 2 more logs. Finally, we see the value and useEffect in action. It's quite unexpected behavior. After diving into debugging, I realized that the request is being sent to the server twice. Just to clarify, I have strict mode disabled, and as soon as I remove the use hook, this strange behavior disappears. I won't speculate on why it's behaving this way. The main point is that the use memo workaround didn't effectively cache the request because our current component behaves oddly, so I decided to tweak the code a bit. I moved the use memo hook to the parent component, as it was in the documentation. Then I passed the promise as props to the comments component, and voila, it worked perfectly without any issues. What we've learned from this experience is that creating a promise directly in the renderer can lead to unusual behavior in React's lifecycle. This is essentially what React was cautioning us about, and now we understand why. Alright, now that we've explored some of the quirks of the use hook, let's move on to its strengths. I've made a few adjustments to the code. First, let's take a look at the getComments method. Now, it returns a response either after 2 seconds or after 5 seconds to test for race conditions. I also added a console log to track when the server's response will be conditional. In the comments component, I've simply added a console log as well. The last piece to consider is the app component. Instead of using article ID, I'm using a counter. As a result, every time the counter value changes, a new comment promise is generated. And of course, I've added a button to increment this counter. Let's see how it works in the browser. We refreshed the page, and after 2 seconds, the initial data loaded. Then, we increased the counter to 6, triggering a flurry of requests to the server. Interestingly, the result displayed corresponds to the most recent query, even though some queries were executed after the last one. What's really impressive here is that the use hook has completely handled the race condition issue and disregarded the need to manage responses from the server. All these challenges are effortlessly resolved out of the box. This is something we've been longing for. But the power of use doesn't stop there. Brace yourself for the highlight of the program. You might want to sit down for this. You can now use the use hook with if conditions. This code will run smoothly without any errors. You can seamlessly integrate use into any conditions. I can't even begin to imagine the possibilities this opens up, but one thing is for certain. This limitation was a real headache. To sum it all up, it seems that now you need at least 2 components to make 1 request. It brings to mind an older era when there was a container responsible for the logic and a view component solely tasked with rendering. Now, on to the last topic, context and ref. Let's delve into an example from the documentation. You no longer need to use the word provider for context. Instead, you create a context and use it with the same name as a JSX tag, but the most interesting change isn't that. A more intriguing update is that you can now use the use hook instead of use context. Yes, that's right, that new hook. And, as you already know, it can be utilized within if conditions, just like in the example from the documentation. This is a handy perk for those who frequently use context in their projects. With refs, the changes aren't overly complicated, but they're quite nice. Now, we can finally pass refs as props. I've never quite understood why there was an issue with passing them as regular props, but thankfully that problem has now been resolved. The second change with refs is the addition of a cleanup function. Here's how it works. If an element is removed from the DOM, you have the option to call some sort of callback. This opens up a completely new opportunity. I haven't quite figured out how to use it yet, but I find the idea very intriguing. Of course, these aren't all the changes detailed in the article, but they're certainly among the most intriguing ones. So, I'll leave a link to the article in the description. If you enjoyed the review, please consider liking and subscribing to the channel. Also, keep an eye out for the conference in May. Bye.